in church on Sunday morning. Grandma's hand played a tambourine so well. Grandma's hand used to issue out a warning. She'd say, Billy, don't you run so fast. Might fall on a piece of glass. Might be snakes there in that grass. Grandma's hand. Grandma's hand soothed the local unwed mother. Grandma's hand used to ache sometimes and swell. Grandma's hand used to lift her face and tell her she'd say, baby, grandma, understand that you really love that man. Put yourself in Jesus' hands, grandma's hand. Grandma's hand used to hand me a piece of candy. Grandma's hand picked me up each time I fell. Grandma's hand, boy, they really came in a handy. She'd say, Matty, don't you whip that boy. What you wanna spank him for? He didn't drop no apple core, but I don't have grandma anymore. If I get to heaven, I'll look for grandma's hand.
Good evening. My name is Andrea Douglas, and I'm the executive director of the Jefferson School African American Heritage Center. And I'd like to welcome you all to our Removing the Mask conversation with Mayor Nakia Walker. Just a little bit of housekeeping before we get started. We've got a full evening tonight, so I just want to jump right in. But we'll begin the conversation with Mayor Walker, and then at around 6:30, we'll turn to our panelists who will join us to continue until about 7:10 when we will have questions from the audience. So please, as you're rolling through, as you're listening, do be thinking about what questions you'd like to ask as we go along. The panelists that will be joining us tonight are Nia Bates, who is the a public historian, the former director of Getting Word, African American Oral History Project at Monticello, and now a PhD candidate in the program of African American Studies at Princeton. Sarad Davenport, who is the VP of Operations and Lead Consultant at TMI Consulting in Richmond. William Jones III, one of the founding members of the Prolific Run crew, and then Dr. Lisa Wolfork, who is the Associate Professor of English at the University of Virginia. So first, let me introduce Mayor Walker, who is born and raised in Charlottesville. She became the first African-American mayor and the first independent candidate to be elected to council in 2018. The first independent person elected to council in 40 years when she became mayor in 2018. She was re-elected as mayor in 2020. In 2017, when she ran for council, her platform was unmasking the illusion. And she describes her service on council as a commitment to authentic inclusion, equity, and progress. In a 2018 Guardian article, Mayor Walker described growing up in Charlottesville as tough. In that same article, she stated that she was here to call attention to the liberal, progressive, democratic structure that's in place that believes that their best intentions are enough. She also stated, and quote, you need actions behind those intentions. You can't just use words. Further on in the article, she states, even though you're not loud, you're not yelling, you're still impacting people's lives in a way that reflects three or four generations or impacts three or four generations. And as a consequence of your actions and that impact, she articulated that she would criticize those actions publicly. So that brings us to our conversation tonight and her March 24th poem that she published on social media. So this is what leads our conversation. And so please let me welcome Mayor Nakia Walker.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mayor Walker. Thank you so much for taking time out to talk with us this evening. I know you've got a lot going on, and so we hope that this will be a fruitful conversation tonight. So I read a little bit about, or I talked a little bit about your 2018 Guardian article mm-hmm. and some of the statements that you made there. And from 2018 to 2021, in some ways, I feel like there hasn't been much change in what you were talking about. So let's talk about the poem. Let's start there. In one place, you mentioned that that poem was in some ways caused by a Washington Post article. So what really prompted the poem? Tell us about why you wrote that.
A lot of frustration. I think anyone who has spent any significant time with me would know that what happened after I posted that poem, I did not expect for that to occur. But I am grateful that it prompted the conversation that it started that I've been attempting to have since 2017 and many years before then for people who had worked with me, but on this larger scale with the entire community. But I was sitting there thinking about how difficult even, you know, getting this work done, social justice, economic justice, ensuring that we're not apologizing for mistakes that we're making today in the future. That is very difficult with my current colleagues and a lot of the staff members at the city. And that day I was just venting really from that frustration. And I decided to, post that frustration, which I often do, so that wasn't a new thing, but it had been a few really tough months, and that's how I felt, and that's what I feel like is happening to the community. I feel like we're all going to be sitting outside of the community at some time in the not-so-distant future, and people are going to be talking about putting plaques up and apologizing to us for the occupying the space that used to be our homeland. And I'm not talking about a couple centuries ago, I'm talking about, 20 and 30 years from now, apologizing to us, the people who are here now, and that there will only be a few people who will be able to make it in this community. And that's not because people desire for us to necessarily be here, that some of us have to be here a little bit sooner to serve at a finger snap. So I am tired of the conversations around that things are changing. And there are things that are changing, but those changes are snail pace changes. And some of these individuals that I am working with, we would if we were in a position where we had to determine to fight a civil war again for our freedom, we would be having the same discussions they had then. And so that poem was about that frustration. I know some people felt violated because of the word choice, but I hope they now maybe understand, because I've been saying similar things since I've been here, but they now understand that we feel that way daily. We feel that level of violation. We feel that level of, pillaging our communities, taking from us. We feel, that level of pain and suffering. And those are the words that came out of me when I was attempting to describe those feelings.
Mm-hmm. And just for clarity's sake, because you've been saying we and us and the community, when you're using those terms, who are you talking about?
I'm talking about the Black community here. I'm talking about low income people here. I think that's one of the things that I might as well go ahead and clear up. One of the struggles I think we have in this community is having someone in my position who is unapologetic about the fact that I'm a Black woman. And I wake up in the morning and I think about Blackness and how we suffer in this country. And I articulate that in every conversation I have. And people often tell me that if I just didn't do that, I would be so much more loved in this community if I just stopped talking about race. And I just go back to 2017. I didn't announce after the summer of hate. I announced before that. And I was clear before that by my color choices, by some of the symbols on my website, that I was proud of the fact that I am a Black woman. And I am very aware of our plight in this country. And I am also equally aware of the joy we bring to our lives and other people's lives. And I wake up every day trying to figure out how to share that. And if people were really in the business of moving out of our way so that we can become as free as possible in this country, then they would embrace that. But it seems that people are fearful of having someone in this position who discusses Blackness openly. And I get that a lot. What about everyone else? And I ask them, tell me a time where I needed to focus on someone else and I didn't. But I can tell you a time that many people who preceded me did not focus on us.
Right. So, this issue of vulgarity, that seems to be, in my mind, just a question of semantics. It was just something for certain people to hang their hat on. Mm-hmm. But I am interested in some of the commentary that was made, because I think there were people who felt blindsided. They felt mm-hmm. that Charlottesville was working towards a more equitable space, and that your general assertion in the poem that nothing had actually changed felt to them that. That was sort of a slap in the face, let's say, mm-hmm. for want of a better way of describing it. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, what do you say to those people? I know you started to talk about it, but let's get a little bit deeper into this idea that we're engaged in a moment of change. How do you mm-hmm. really feel about that?
So I think immediately after August of 2018, the tone started shifting in rooms. I think many people in positions of power, particularly white people in this community, thought that, hey, 2017 didn't happen again. And do we have to continue to have these discussions at the pace that we're having it? So that's one. Also, talk is, as the saying goes, cheap, right? So we can talk all day, we can have committees all day, but there are people who do not have time for us to sit in these rooms and talk and debate and, put things off. During this budget cycle, I brought up that there were three bullet points put up on the budget as things that were tipping the budget over. And one of them, was affordable housing. And over the next 5 years, we're putting about $40, $50 million into affordable housing. I think it's 50. so many numbers. We just wrapped up budget season, but it's not enough. That's what I do know. And I made the comment that we're talking about almost $1 billion in revenue over that same time frame. That we are saying that $50 is enough. And so some members of the community think that's better than zero. But I look at it as if you've neglected a community for decades, then you can't take another few decades to mend it. When you're serious about reparations, when you're serious about repair, then you do that with a sense of urgency, as if you were, as if your family were the ones living in the, you know, abject poverty that a lot of our families are living in. 22% of our families in this community live in poverty. And so we can't take our time coming out of that. And so that's the frustration. The city laid off over 300 people, the most vulnerable workers in the community, most of whom were white. So for people who say that I only focus on us, I do focus on us proudly, but I just don't only focus on us. So most of those individuals were not Black, Brown, or other people of color. But they are working low income, clearly working for the lowest wage in the city. And my colleagues were comfortable with not figuring out a way to keep them, you know, on board. Those type of actions translate into what they'll do with community members. When we can fly descendants like Sacagawea's descendants in, and we still have a very loud white community members telling us what they desire to happen to the statue versus listening to the descendants, those type of moments that have happened in the past 3 years are the moments that let me know where we still are.
Mm-hmm. So do you, and this just as a kind of counter to that, that you it seems that you're expressing a level of impatience with the pace of it. But do you think that in the time that you have on council, how much real systemic change are you feeling like you're going to be able to make in this time? You know, you're coming close to the end here.
Yeah, no, I was on the a call with some council members, former and current, out of Richmond. A few months back. And we were talking about the Home to Hope program. They were interested in that after watching and reading the press on it after the first year update. And, you know, these women have been in doing this work for a lot longer than I have. And they asked me, which I get asked often when I'm speaking, how does this work without you? Mm-hmm. And, yeah, I told them I didn't know, and I don't know the answer to that. It takes a lot of commitment and persistence to get this stuff done, even as slow pace as it's being done, which people often tell me that it's pretty quickly. But on a systemic level, I don't think anything has really changed, because if it did, my answer would be it will work perfectly without me being here, because these are the things that have changed, and I can't honestly say that.
Mm-hmm. So one of the things that when you were first elected, that we some of us were really focused on, was that you were the only native of Charlottesville on council at the time mm-hmm. that you were elected, right? And so would have brought with you a particular kind of understanding, very much like what you've been describing to this point. Now you're on council with someone like Lloyd Snook, who is also a native of Charlottesville, right? And in some ways that should put to some rest the idea that council is made of people who have not come from here, who don't really understand the conditions of being an indigenous person, whatever you want to describe that as being, and what those sort of historic issues are. So what would you describe as the difference between your notion of native and Lloyd Snook's native?
I think the best way to probably address that is by the conversations that are going on across this country, right? So Black people, even when you are at home, you are not at home. And so I think being Native, I was speaking back in 2017 and even today, and what I've done my whole life is to talk about the Black experience in this community. I would say, you know, Lloyd Snook as a white male who has a lot of privilege now, and I think he had a lot of privilege when he was growing up. I haven't spent a significant enough time with his background, but I think that's what I remember. Lloyd Snook would be home anywhere in America. And what he brings to the table, how he spent the majority of his time, I would say, is very different than I have had the luxury of spending my time. So being from here and being able to know like roadways and where buildings used to be and, you know, who used to work where, and being able to personally, discuss where you were on certain dates and what other white people were in power at that time is very different from, I hope, the native that people were thinking about when they thought, oh, what could she bring to the table and to the rooms? So I bring a very different perspective of a people who have lived primarily, unless you were a few who managed to make it out in, kind of pain and turmoil here. Mothers not knowing if their daughters and sons would make it, and understanding the systemic and institutional impacts that people in power, the decisions they made, how it impacted our lives. So that's what I would say would be the main difference. But I could think about that a little bit more. Yeah.
But generally speaking, along those lines, then, as people are talking about a council member, I'm not even going to say mayor. Let's just call it council member, right? Mm-hmm. Because allegedly, I can't remember where we saw it, but somebody held up a hand and they were like, council is five individual fingers and something. I think it was a council meeting where something like that went down. I can't remember.
My finger is dangling off. Just down there, grab it, stitch it back on. Maybe, I don't know.
But as you begin to think about like the work and the partnerships and the way Charlottesville has to engage with the university, mm-hmm. or as a city, Charlottesville as a city has to engage with the university and has to engage with Albemarle County, for instance. The value of having people who have at least had some level of similar experience in relationship to that. Mm-hmm. The question I guess I'm driving towards is it possible to take your perspective, his perspective, and then the other perspectives of the other members of council, to actually manage a city that is so that has gone through so much since 2017. How is that all sort of the dynamics of that, given who you're speaking to when you're sitting in the other rooms?
Yeah, it's definitely important to know what has happened here and how that has impacted people. But I think also equally as important is whether you then take that knowledge that you have, and if you're able to look at the city through an equity lens. And what does that equity lens mean? I often have debates, just a couple council meetings ago, during a discussion, well, not really a debate, just a discussion I'm usually having by myself, but I attempt to open it up that way, but about housing. And I had posted a house just down the street that I think it was $449,000, two bedroom and one bath. And there's all of these, you know, people who criticize me that I don't understand, that we need to meet the demand and allow these developers to build. And then there will be fancy places for people to go and they'll leave these older homes. And if homes are selling and have been selling $300,000, $400,000, and you are talking about lower income people earning under $35,000, everybody can do that math and go to bankrate.com and understand people can't buy those homes. That's just simple, even if I didn't know anything else. There's a handy dandy calculator on bankrate.com, and you know that math doesn't work. But it's just that faulty thinking of that we can kind of build our way out of this. And we know in a city like Charlottesville that has such high demand that people are going to pretty much move anywhere that's available to them. And the assumption that there's a place for everybody without us being intentional about it is really faulty. So Lloyd has been one to champion, and I know I'm not going to spend a lot of time on him, but he's been one to champion that let us build and kind of see what happens. And I know what's going to happen. Now, the people who voted primarily for Lloyd, they're not going to be impacted if Lloyd is, right. If I am right and we go with Lloyd's plan to let's see what happened, then there are a lot of us who are no longer able to be here. And those UVA and county, relationships are very important, but we also have to be very clear when we're talking about regionalism that everyone didn't start having the discussion in 2017 the way we did. And people don't desire necessarily to have that same, conversation. And so part of this is about making sure that our house is in order so that we can show people that there's a better way to do things and being comfortable enough when we're in those rooms with the regional partners to push them a little bit more. And I can tell you that it's not something that often happens without me. I don't know what happens without me in the room because I'm not in there, but I know I'm usually the only one in the room who is pushing back on people with a lot of power. UVA, I'm thinking about right now with their affordable housing commitment, pushing back on them to really understand even what true partnership with that looks like. So you have to have people that see clearly what the root of the issues are. And I don't know how many of my colleagues picked up the phone and called UVA and told them when they laid off their most vulnerable employees at the beginning of the pandemic and thought they could live off unemployment, but I did. I called and told them that that was unacceptable.
So I'm gonna go back to this idea. I skated over this idea of the language in the poem being vulgar.
Okay.
But I want to go back to it for a minute because what also came up was a lot of conversation about decorum and the way that an elected official is supposed to act.
Yeah.
Right? And what an elected official is supposed to say if they are trying to create a space of prosperity for their city.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So, and in some places, I saw one person called you eccentric.
Mm.
Right? So, and this goes to this idea of unmasking the illusion.
Yeah.
What you've been attempting to do to this point.
Oh, the illusion is shattered. I just want to say that. Sorry, but oh yeah. Whew. All right, moving back to business.
No, well, but to that point though, the illusion is shattered.
Yeah.
You know, so is an elected official, in your mind, is it the job of the elected official to shatter the illusion, or is it to maintain the illusion? How do we really move forward if we're still living in a space of where some of us, whether we're impoverished or black or white, have an understanding that there is this place is not, living in this place is not the same for everyone who lives here.
Yeah. I think it's important, I think we ask too much of elected officials, people in power. Like, we have emotions. I'm assuming they do too. You know, you feel all the spectrum of emotions, and I think we should be able to express that. I never told anybody that I was this polished individual, nor have I ever pretended to be. I don't desire to be. I've never been able to pretend. I don't know if I'd be able to pretend if I desired to be, but I just don't desire it. I'm not attached to this position now. Not attached to next, you know, whatever. It just, life happens, things change. I have never had the luxury of being able to have like peace and consistency. So not having it doesn't bother me. I am only concerned with freedom, justice, equality. I don't want to be included in anything just so you can have a black person there. I'm not interested in that. You can dress yourself up black if that's what you want. And let people talk about you after you do that foolishness. But I'm not interested in it. And white people get away with so much, and then they expect us to come, you know, in the rooms and have everything together. And I have seen people for years try to meet those standards. And even once they think they've reached them and they pleased white people, they get pushed back down. And, every time I walk in a room, I have stories, so much history. My great grandmother was born in 1914, and I got to spend a significant amount of time with her. My grandmother that just passed was born in 1935. I took care of my aunt a few years ago. She was born in 1920. I can tell you from their stories, the stories we're sharing today, they are not different. From the person who tries to check all the boxes, get all the degrees, and you know, all the social clubs to make sure that they build those relationships and have those connections, to people like me who just really had no desire to even attempt to check all the boxes. We all get treated the same way at the end of the day. They rape us, they take from us, they pillage us. They build their empires off the backs of us. That's all I'm interested in having. Anytime I see anything that shows me that the experience that my grandmother had in 1920s and 30s, 50s, 60s, 70s, that is the same experience that we're having today, I call it out. Mm-hmm. And people tell me, you didn't even wait. You don't know where I was going with that. I don't need to have the experience again. So we're going to stop this right now. You know, I've heard enough stories. I've had enough experiences on my own. And that is one of the things that came up with the poem. you know, I sent someone a message and I said, you know, my own personal story, all the work I've done, all the critics who said I used a word that they apparently thought that I shouldn't have been able to use, they don't know my story. But I let them talk because that, again, was one of those times that show us Black people, Black women are never even afforded their own emotions. Like, I couldn't even have a personal story for the original meaning of rape, mm-hmm. right? That I used that to somehow abuse them.
Right.
That it was senseless. And even that took me back to, you know, having a very similar conversation with one of the nonprofit owners who told me that if I would just come out publicly and apologize for supporting Wes and his tweets, that they would support me. You don't ever have to worry about it. Support me if that's what you want me to do. And so we, again, are in a community that's 70% white. And even the most progressive and liberal people, I am, again, I'll take a Nazi flag wearing, tattooed forehead, chest, hands and feet any day over what I experience from the people who claim they get it.
Okay, so we're going to bring our other panelists in and continue the conversation. So, thank you all for joining us. We greatly appreciate it. I'm going to start our conversation with Nya Bates. I've got a question for you. Given the work that you do, I'm hoping that this isn't too big a question for you, but as a historian of this place, you've studied Charlottesville, you've studied Albemarle County, you've worked at Monticello. The fact that your family has a history here that dates back to enslavement. From that particular perspective, can you make some comments on the development of race relations here? How do you view it as a young woman who has, you know, been connected in this kind of way?
Absolutely. Mayor Walker ended with her grandparents, so I'll start with mine. My grandfather was born Otto Landers Bates in 1908. Here in Albemarle County. My grandmother was born in 1927 in Albemarle County. And it's true that the Black population here has always been centered on the struggle for freedom. And the reaction that Mayor Walker has faced is not new. So I'm gonna try to keep this super short because I could talk about this all day because I got family stories for days and days and days about what it's been like to be Black in this area. But, you know, I'll just give some brief perspective on kind of the setup. How did we get to this moment? So Black residents in Charlottesville and Albemarle, even during slavery, were committed to freedom. They pursued their own freedom by fighting in the U.S. colored troops during the Civil War, fighting for the Union. They self-liberated by running away, whether that was to Ohio or to cities, Richmond, D.C., areas north of Charlottesville, or whether that was fleeing as far west as Ohio. So Black people here have always sought their own freedom. And every time they've sought to make progress, they've been met with backlash and gaslighting and everything that shuts down that attempt, that pursuit for freedom. So even in the years right after slavery, when Albemarle is still 54% Black, race relations here are terrible. Black families, Black individuals began building institutions. They built schools and churches and fraternal groups and other things that were meant to mark their newfound freedom. In 1867, there's a Black representative from Albemarle County who actually goes to the state legislature and represents our area along with over 100 other Black representatives. But unfortunately, that is also met with backlash. So with the official end of the Reconstruction in 1877, you start to see the ramping up of Jim Crow. At that point, there is no 40 acres and a mule. There's no one coming to save Black residents in our area. Black Charlottesville is largely living in segregated spaces during this time. So From the 1880s forward, Black Charlottesville is living in areas where we still currently live, living in Star Hill, living in Vinegar Hill, the 10th and Page neighborhood, Fifeville, the Rose Hill area. Those are the spaces that were, because of racial housing covenants and redlining, reserved for Black residents. So they start to build in the spaces that they do have. And every single time, they get the same backlash. On July 12th, 1898, there's the lynching of John Henry James. And not 20 years later, in 1915, over 1,000 people gathered to lynch two Black men outside of the court here for their alleged assault of a police officer. So these are relevant points marking how similar our times are now to how they've been, you know, even over 100 years ago. In 1921, the Klan starts to rise again in our area, and they mark that growth by meeting at Thomas Jefferson's grave at Monticello, effectively making Charlottesville a sundown town. Charlottesville, Scottsville, Somerset, a lot of these areas outside of the city of Charlottesville are sundown places, but even the city itself is not safe for Black residents after dark. So whatever successes they're having during the day, whether they're starting their own businesses, whether they are making a way out of no way, they're met with violence. They're met with violence from students at the university, from white residents in Charlottesville, and especially from elite people seeking to cut off Black businesses and Black success in this area. So the 1920s, because of all of that, you start to see outward migration. From the 1920s forward, Charlottesville and Albemarle are no longer predominantly Black spaces. People move away for opportunities. They move away from the violence here. They move away so that they can have a better future. Most of the people who remain end up doing the same types of work that they were doing under slavery. So the majority of Black residents in this area were bound to low-wage jobs. They're working as domestic laborers. They are working as farm labor. They're working in trades work that is based on an hourly wage where they're not making enough money to break that cycle of poverty. So let's just rinse and repeat that story for the next five or six generations. And that is how you get to Charlottesville today. My own family, my grandparents worked at the same plantations where our family was enslaved well into, like even until my lifetime. I knew people who were still working on these plantations, who were cooking, who were cleaning, who were making these places successful. So that is the story of race relations in Black Charlottesville, that they've been virtually the same since the 19-teens and 1920s. And every time, like I said, things that are typically markers of success within the Black community are met with violence in this area. So the destruction of Vinegar Hill is a prime example of what happens when Black communities start to have too much economic power and their own economic wealth, that they are then destroyed through eminent domain and moved out of the city. Homeowners in those neighborhoods were forced into public housing and subsidized housing. So homeowners then become renters and people who rely on vouchers to cover housing. And this is because the system wanted it that way, that it moved these communities into those spaces. I'll give another example. In the 1950s, my uncle, James Quarles, fought in the army in the Korean War. And when he came home, people shot at his house because he was seen then as a Black man in uniform to be uppity, to be someone who is deserving of violence. And so over and over again, we see success within the Black community met with violence. My cousin, Donald Duck Bates, is part of integrating the schools at Stone Robinson Elementary in the 1960s. Again, that's also met with violence. Charlottesville participates in massive resistance, closes down schools. People miss out on the opportunity for education. And it's through the perseverance of people like Reverend R.A. Johnson, Mr. Eugene Williams, and others who really fought that battle to get Black students access to better schools and better education in this area. So today we still have all of these lasting disparities that are rooted in generations of the same dispossession of Charlottesville's Black community. Our housing disparities, educational disparities, employment disparities, health disparities. We could keep going on and on and on and on. But the point is that there is never a great migration to Charlottesville. So largely, Black people who live here today are descendants of the same Black people who have been marginalized and dispossessed and the recipients of this violence for multiple generations. And so that today we're a community living with the racial trauma of decades of dispossession and disenfranchisement.
Yeah. Thank you, Naya. Thank you. That really sort of, you know, when you're starting to think about holding that history up against what Nakaya has written in her words, you begin to see in some real ways what she's talking about. Lisa, I wanted to ask you because you did a Facebook post where you referenced Titus Kaffir's Beyond the Myth of Benevolence after Rembrandt Peale's portrait of Jefferson from 1800. As you were talking about that. And you've also written an op-ed recently about how good intentions are performed in Charlottesville. Can you discuss what you mean by that? What were you getting at in that way?
What I was getting at was, as soon as I read the mayor's poem, this image came to mind. This is the Titus Kaffir image. He's a well-renowned artist. This portrait hung in the National Portrait Gallery. And I think that this is the title of this picture, the portrait is called The Myth of Benevolence. And it seems to me a perfect illustration of Charlottesville. If Charlottesville was to have a self-portrait and if it were honest about itself, it would look a lot like this. And the reason I turned in this direction is because there are folks who would have us believe that what Mayor Walker has written is excessive, is harmful. But what we can actually learn from looking at this image is that what she actually drew, or what she actually drew with her words, with her own language, was the true story of Charlottesville. And in the same way that Kaffir takes down this idealized portrait of Jefferson, just shifts it to the side just a bit to show us what's behind that image, is a firm endorsement, in my opinion, of the exploitation, the violence, and the extraction that happens to Black folks in this community all the time. It feels as though what we are living through, Andrea, is a circle of cycles. And one of those cycles is that it seems like almost what feels to me like every other week we are living through what Martin Luther King wrote about in 1963 in a letter from a Birmingham jail. Mm-hmm. And this way he's proving to us what King wrote was that he is more the white moderate who is more devoted to order than to justice is harmful. Those folks who prefer peace on their own terms, this peace, which really means silence, as opposed to a peace that's based on justice, this is what we are getting here. This is how this has landed. And one of the things that it's taught me or reinforced for me, because I already believe this, and as a literature professor, I think it's important to note that euphemism is violence. And by that, I mean, you can take something that is really horrible, really terrible, but you give it a name that is inoffensive. And when you do this, you really diminish the consequence of what is at stake. So for example, we know even terms like race relations is really a very strange word to talk about the violent extraction of resources from Black communities. They'll even talk about a Tulsa race riot as opposed to a mob attack by white people on Black people to destroy lives and property. Peculiar institution being used to describe slavery. We do this all the time. And once one becomes accustomed to euphemism and you confuse euphemism with professionalism, then it's doomed. It's not possible to have an honest conversation. Because one of the things that this situation has exposed for me is the fallacy and the danger of conducting anti-racist work with white people's feelings at the center of it. That is a limitation that is impossible, in my opinion, to overcome. Because rather than talking about justice and liberation, you instead talk about diversity and equity and inclusion, and that all of these things are the same and everyone is diverse and everyone should be equal to everyone else. And let us include you in the structure that we already have, rather than changing and generating a new structure that will actually work for everyone. So my response in the work, the stuff that I talked about on Facebook and the letter to the editor that I wrote was about exposing the motivations behind euphemism and why we should be distrustful of that. Because euphemism doesn't operate to help the marginalized. Euphemism operates to help the people that are doing the harm. And one of the things that happens in Charlottesville all the time is that civility is weaponized. It is weaponized against people, against Black people in particular, who are not in their place and who are not doing their anti-racist work or not trying to dismantle white supremacy in ways that makes white people happy. And so this notion of this happens often to Black women in particular. This is the same kind of community that replaces Black people with Black Lives Matter signs. You know, let's get the Black people out because they can't afford to live here, but we'll put up a Black Lives Matter sign. We'll say hashtag listen to Black women until a Black woman says something that might hurt a white person's feelings or makes a white person feel uncomfortable. Even I'm pretty sure that me saying the word white people, as much as I've said the word white people, has made some white people hella uncomfortable. You know, even these minimal things that are just obvious and basic, become sites of powerful anxiety that needs to be contained. And this is something that I have always appreciated about Nakia, is her integrity, it's her honesty, it's her commitment to justice. And this, the work that she did was no exception to that. And the reaction to her work, a reaction to this poem, the complete outsized gaslighting, disproportionate response is because this is a Black woman who is free and who wants other people to be free as well. And she is not playing by the games of the Democratic Party that has enshrined white liberalism as an ideal. She is not, that's not what she's interested in. She's interested in getting to the core of real problems and executing real change. And you can't do that if you aren't even willing to say what is happening in language that is honest and transparent.
All right. Sarad. Thank you, Lisa. I don't even know what to say to that except thank you, because I'm coming around to an idea in a minute. Sarad, we have had a couple conversations, and one of those conversations you had talked about the glass ceiling in Charlottesville, and like Naya, your family is deeply rooted here. You're from here. Your father was an activist during the Black Power movement. You've worked for City of Promise and you continue to be engaged with youth in our community. So my question for you is, where do you sit today? How would you define the glass ceiling that you spoke about maybe 3 years ago? What does it feel like now?
Yeah, just remembering that comment that I made, I didn't just call it a glass ceiling, I call it a thick glass ceiling. Yeah. But you know, I think I center everything around this issue of actualization, right? And the right, the God-given right for Black people to actualize and become their full selves in their existence, you know, on the earth and in here in, you know, in Charlottesville. So and what are those factors that contribute to preventing them from that type of actualization? And then I began to look at those factors and those key indicators. And one of those key indicators that I often look at is health, right? We can look at health as an indicator of quality of life or well-being. And we see all of these kind of chronic illnesses. We see all of these outcomes with regards to education and wealth building and construction. And then what are the forces that are perpetuating this lack of actualization in these domains, right? And why is it that it seemingly, you know, the narrative is that it happens by happenstance and that it is not contrived or prescribed or designed, right? And my questions are often around design and what designs are being contrived to produce certain outcomes for Black people, right? Wherever they find themselves. And I think that that is part of the real question, you know, and that could speak, you know, into the poem that was written. We're not having a real conversation usually, right? About those factors that are contributing to preventing people from actualizing and being themselves. I had a conversation with Dr. Wolfork and, you know, anybody else. I have a conversation about Toni Morrison, who described racism as a distraction. And what racism does, according to Toni Morrison, is it prevents us from actually being our greatest selves and actualizing in place. And what we found that, you know, segregation was, there was a double-edged sword. And oftentimes those were the glory times or the golden years of the African-American community when they were isolated and excluded from persecution, right? And in isolation and exclusion from persecution, then innovation can happen, right? And ecosystems can be developed where people can actualize, right? And so that wasn't gonna work, especially for those who have you know, a belief that there is an inherent inferiority of Black people, right? And that plays into the economic, you know, destruction that is necessary to perpetuate the status quo and to stay on top in the economic structure, right? So that had to be destroyed, right? And so, you know, my work is often around those real things that contribute to actualization and then those design factors that contribute to preventing them. And how do we reconstruct healthier structures? And I speak in code sometimes. How do we reconstruct a healthier algorithm that will produce the outcome or the impact that we want to see in communities? And the question is, you know, are people going to be fair? Are they going to play fair? Right? Are we going to, because if we're not going to play fair and construct together an algorithm that will produce an impact that it you know, allows all of us to thrive and to actualize, then let's be honest about that. Right? Let's be honest about, you know, fair play and being an honest broker in a system that may cause you to have to give up something in order for everyone else to thrive, survive, and actualize in the system. So, you know, going back to that glass ceiling, it's there. The wealth gap is constructed. It is by design, and it is not a representative of, you know, fair play in the ecosystem. And I think we have to do that if we're truly, I don't care whether you're liberal, progressive, conservative, if you're truly about community, you say you are, then you have to be an honest broker in that space. And if you're not, you know, be open about that. If you don't want to see actualization of Black people within the society, I'd rather you just be upfront than to try to play with me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's interesting. And I think we're starting to build a set of ideas that we're going to get back to. Hopefully we'll have enough time for all of us to be really engaged in one quick conversation. But Will, let me turn to you for a minute, because I think that when, as you know, I've walked with Prolific. You all are a large group of body of people who've come together around a kind of notion of community and a desire to create community. Tell me, first, let me ask you, in your own words, what was Prolific created to accomplish?
Prolific was intended from the start to be sort of a brand that will highlight talents in our community, art-wise, create clothing line that would be fresh. Prolific is, it was intended to always be like somewhere where we could like highlight all of what we do in our community, where we could like bring attention to people like Mayor Nakia Walker and the awesome work that she does, to people like Yolanda Harrell and awesome work that she does, to people like Lisa, who does awesome work, where we could honor people like them and just use our brand to just show off people in our community that did amazing things. Run These Streets was a totally separate thing. I intended from the start to run through neighborhoods where I would have lived had I grown up in Charlottesville and be seen. What we ended up doing was naming the Run Crew Prolific, because the Run Crew was doing work that we intended for Prolific to do. And the Run Crew represented well the Prolific brand. And so we named the Run Crew after that. But what the Run Crew is today is still separate and different from what it was intended to be from the onset. And the onset, I didn't expect white people to come out. I just really expected it to be just us running through these neighborhoods. I was never against white people coming out, but that wasn't the intention. I wanted my people to see me, to see us running through these neighborhoods. I think the evolution happened because Run is something that happens in Charlottesville, and we have a lot of people who are, one, really wanting to do something with their energy and learn more about Black people, or they're just looking for places to feel better. And when COVID happened, I think it gave people an opportunity to like, okay, let me see if my energy here will amount to something. And we were able to create a real community just because we just are real people. Although the space wasn't intended to be a multicultural space, I'm not like a hater. And so I love everybody. And so I accept everybody, as long as you understand, you know, what we here doing. And we challenge race, and we challenge male chauvinism, and we challenge, you know, these archaic mind frames that stop people from being counted. You know, one of the slogans that we really say a lot is that we here, and that's because we want to be seen. We want to be counted for. And so even though our space is heavily populated with white people now, that wasn't the intention in the onset, but it is what our community actually looks like. And so I think that it is what we should look like if we were going to, you know, accurately represent and effectively cause some sort of change, because people need to experience people in order to really get involved with the struggle. And we about the struggle. And so anybody that comes over, you know, either they're going to be about the struggle or they're going to leave, I think, or they're going to play and wear a mask for long enough to where they get exposed. And, you know, that goes the way it goes.
Yeah. And you know, at the end of the walk, at the end of the run, there's this group that comes together, and you really sort of highlight those things that you're talking about. So I'm going to go to questions in about 7 minutes, but I want to sort of lead into another question that Will sort of touches on, although in some form, it's about the future in one respect, but it's also about this idea of how do we move forward. If we're all in agreement, generally speaking, that the condition of Blackness in Charlottesville is one of as Nakai has described it, as of being pillaged, of resources being taken. How do we actually move forward? This idea of allyship, a little bit suspect of the notion of allyship personally. So let's start with that. Let's talk a little bit about this idea of allyship. Can anyone just sort of speak to what they understand this idea of allyship to be? Lisa, you should do that. And then Nakai, you can follow up.
I don't know why I get to go in front of Nakai, but I'll say I don't want no allies.
I saw your hat for hand first.
I don't want allies, no thank you. I need accomplices. Accomplices are people who have a stake in this just as much as I do, that when consequences land, they land evenly on all of us. And this notion that allyship is somehow, it has really become corrupted just like so many other things have become corrupted. But I think what we actually need is accomplices. At the same time, we need to recognize that white supremacy is not something Black people invented or created or benefit from. And why should I be bothered cleaning up that mess? And that's something that white people need to do, not me. And this question of the distraction of racism, as Sarat mentioned, it's one of my favorite Morrison quotes, that this is white people's problem. And we will never, I sometimes get concerned about moving forward because sometimes I hear, and I think other people hear, move on. And as Sankofa principles teach us, you can't move forward without acknowledging the past. And Naya did such a gorgeous job of describing what the Black past in Charlottesville has been and what we reside on today. That is still happening. It is still real. And yeah, I often, you know, people always, they often ask me, well, what are we going to do about it? And I was like, what are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about it? Mm-hmm. Stop breaking things that belong to me. Stop hurting me and harming me. You want to violate me and harm me, and you want me to make the solution too? No, thank you. That is a trap, and I will not fall for it.
Okay, how about you? How would you respond to that? And really also to, I don't want to orchestrate this, so you all just jump in and say what you want to say, really. Because I'd rather us be in dialogue than me being like, and now you, and now you, and now you. Because at this point, you know, we should be able to say what we want to say. We're all friends here.
So I think, you know, I came in very optimistic, even with all of my life experiences to 2017. I have still always thought that change was possible and worth working for, even if I had to sacrifice. The past year, I'm in a different space, and I'm trying to spend some time healing so that I can get out of that space. The way that I've been burned, attempting to partner with people who thought they were allies or could be, being hopeful that, you know, the community had screened the people that they were promoting, doing campaign cycles. And the problem may not be them. The problem may be me. We are in a world where we're probably not ready for everybody to be free. And I'm a threat to that. And so I spend most of my time probably trying to maintain my sanity at this point. But because I'm just a natural fighter, and there are things that exhaust me, but even if I am exhausted, I'm going to still fight, right? And so even the fact that people don't have that stamina, I've been criticized for that. I've been criticized that I'm too, you know, that I talk about being Black too much. I've been criticized for not being patient enough by people who are not living in poverty, who kids. I mean, I asked Counselor Hill when we were having a meal tax discussion, this 1 cent, what changes in your family's life as a result of it? But if you go back and listen to those conversations, and people did it with COVID, they are doing it with, you know, trying to reopen things during this time. they want to talk about the Black experience in Charlottesville when they want schools to reopen. They weren't thinking about Black kids and the achievement gap or whatever. You didn't care about it for decades, but now because your kids are not in school, you want to talk about how far behind Black kids are going to be if we don't open the schools back up. You want to talk about the fact that you can afford ACAC, which some of the people who were saying that can't afford ACAC, I can't afford it either, but you all were lying. But you need the pools open because you don't have any money either. And but you didn't say that. You came in and said that kids don't have anywhere to swim and they need to cool off in the summer. And then there was one individual who came and said, you know, told this, you know, very touching story about how they started a business with their parents, the money from their parents' death. And now I was the reason that business would not you know, continue to exist. I'm one person. And that conversation, I was all five of us. I was the whole hand, not the dangling finger that had been chopped off by, you know, one in the butcher shop. But anyway, that's what I felt when you said that. So I just wanted to say that. But the fact that I wasn't focused on capitalism and I was actually focused on people's lives, the public health standpoint, and who would actually be impacted. Who did you want in these grocery stores working? Who was going to take care of your kids in the daycare so that you could work from home? These were people. You can't work from home with your income not being reduced with your kids in the house. We're back to Black people take, my grandmothers worked as domestics. My aunt that I took care of worked as a domestic. Taking care of making, you know, white people's families and then coming home to take care of their own. And I hear those type of comments when you say you still need somebody to be able to come to work so that you can work. When we have to figure all of that stuff out all the time with no, you know, not without that level of assistance. So part of this is just a reminder of why some people are not motivated for us to be free, because then they can't use us in this very wealthy community. And then some people who pretend they are wealthier than they are, the way that they have used us for centuries. And that is disturbing. And so then people say, well, I have good intentions. And your good intentions don't matter. I can't even say what I'm thinking right now. But they just don't matter, you know? And you're talking about generations of people who haven't even figured out how to dream and hold on to those dreams. And you want someone to care about your temporary feelings, about the fact that you can't sit at home in a comfortable $1 million, $500,000 house with your kids for a few months so that we can all survive a virus. And the fact that I focus on the public health standpoint. So what I've seen over the past years and what people in this community miss, you know, some people say I wrote the poem to distract from my criminal behavior of stealing money from the city. And I tell everybody, if I had stolen anything, believe me, everybody have seen that mugshot, because they wouldn't have waited. But I think it comes back to when your moral compass has been set, right, in a different way. My grandmother, my mother, they are never going to have me sit in front of them and explain to them how I took something that somebody could then charge me with. On the flip side of that, it's not theirs to begin with. This city doesn't have the wealth that it has. The university doesn't have the wealth that it's had because it's these brilliant people running it. They have this wealth because they have raped, pillaged the community. So you have what you have because you've stolen it. And so while I'm not going to take it because I'm not foolish and I know what would happen to me, we need to really look at what the allies sat back and watched, right? They watch someone say, of course, this Black woman is morally corrupt. Of course, she's trying to buy votes and buy people to agree with her, because why else would they? $850 is all we need to sell ourselves to me, right? For votes in this community. The entire council just voted on a policy change so that if I do any of the things I formerly did, it would be illegal just because they didn't tell me that I could do it. And what it came down to is my colleagues who are, some of them are lazy and a lot of them are incompetent. And I know I shouldn't say these things, and I know I'm going to lose future votes if I decide to run, but that's y'all loss. Okay. But saying we want credit for your work. When did that happen before? Anybody wants to yell out enslavement? We're supposed to be past that. But you want me to work all night, take naps, get up and work. In 2020, through two major health issues with my family members, a pandemic, a very active mayor, counselor, pushed the city to take people's health safely. I still was the only person who submitted a new proposal last year. Even with all the stuff I had going on personally, and I have my colleagues tell me that I'm trying to take credit for everything. No. I actually am doing these things. And I just shared with one of them yesterday. I said, if you want an idea, have one and present it. If you want a proposal, create one and then give it to us. Where, at what point in history do you understand that we are tired of doing the work and you all getting credit for it? We were just having that conversation yesterday. That is what allyship is still in Charlottesville. Yeah. We kumbaya it so we can get the benefit of your hard work. And we can say that we are part of it. And then we tell the community very loudly in whispers, because that's how white people do it, that you are not a team player. You are not one of the five because you won't allow us to stand on your back and hold ourselves up.
Yeah. Naya, you mentioned something about Naya, you mentioned something about I Love Seaville. What were you talking about when you were talking about that?
Oh man. Yeah, let's get into I Love Seaville, because I feel like the loudest critic that I saw to this poem was Jerry Miller on I Love Seaville. And I think there's a way that we've come to understand the history of our area, cherry picking all the things we like. There are wineries, there are breweries, there are bike paths and walking trails and hiking and kayaking. And it's not that Black people don't do those things. We like to be outside too. Black joy exists. We love all those spaces just as you do. But our love is a different love. It's a double consciousness, as Du Bois labeled it, right? It's an awareness that this place has also been violent, that these breweries and wineries that you like to hang out at are former plantations. You know, my ancestors worked that land, and I might go enjoy a glass of wine at that space, but I never forget the labor and the sacrifice that got me to this point. So I think, you know, one of the things that Charlottesville needs to do to move forward is to be honest about what's in our past. You know, we have to be willing to engage the ugly parts of our history. We have to be willing to work with all of the story and not just the somethings of it, as Ta-Nehisi Coates says, that we also need to embrace the low points, because it's in those low points that really tell us about where we're really at. I don't think we understand how ugly Charlottesville really is until we start to grapple with the things that I was talking about at the beginning of this, the beginning of this panel. I don't think we are grappling with the true ugliness of Charlottesville if we're not talking about the ways that people continue to gaslight the mayor by saying that she's an angry Black woman, right? We have to deal with all those things, all those cancers in our society if we're gonna move forward. So my thing about I Love Seaville is that yes, Black people love Seaville. We want to love Seaville. You know, this is our home. This is the place that we literally built from the ground up. But our love is not a love that can rest comfortably without engaging the ugliest parts of our past.
Yeah, I think to say something to that, to kind of maybe tie both of those ideas together, with allyship. I think what allyship has kind of become is this new landing place where people can feel good about themselves and not really actually do any work. And I think people such as who you just spoke of is having to really recognize where they are in this moment. I think, like, when I think about myself, it's easy to look at what you've done wrong personally. And let me say it this way. It feels to me like white people are able to look at history and see what was wrong in it. But when you start talking about their current conditions and how they aren't doing the work that needs to be done now, it lands really different. And so some people can stand up and announce Vinegar Hill and how they are appalled at what was done in Vinegar Hill, but they aren't recognizing how they are contributing to that same thing right now. And so it's like a woman could tell a man that, you know, I'm using an archaic way of thinking right now. A woman could tell a man, like, I need a home and I need you to build it like this. And he can go out and do it however he wants to do it, but he not do the kitchen the way that she wanted him to. And she'll be telling him, like, yo, this ain't the kitchen that I needed. And he just won't. I gave you this whole house, but you ain't give me the kitchen the way that I wanted. I'm using an archaic way of thinking, I know. It's really hard for men. It's hard for people to hear what they have done wrong, what they are doing wrong right now. I fixed the whole house for you, but Joker, you ain't do what was needed. And so I think people like who you were talking about, they feel really good about doing all this other work. But when somebody like Mayor Walker says what she says, the reason that he can't receive it is because a lot of people haven't really done anti-racist work on themselves. And so they are just like receiving this title of allyship without actually like delivering themselves from the societal trap. And like Saraz spoke earlier about coding. This country has coded us to be racist. And if you haven't done deliberate work to be anti-racist, you are racist. And so when a woman says what she says and you can't receive it, if you are actually an ally, you would never call her on the carpet and say, I want her job, if you were actually an ally. Because if you're an ally, you actually feel her. You actually understand what she's saying. You don't understand what she's saying because you aren't an ally. But people are able to like fly under this banner as liberals, and it's just not what they actually are. They don't have any stake in the game, like Lisa spoke to earlier.
And real quick, because Will, if we were going to get everything but the kitchen, the rest of the house,
yeah,
then we might even be to the question earlier where Andrea, yeah, isn't we moving forward? Aren't we moving forward? What just popped in my head was that white people will give us some seeds and say, you know, this is the eco-friendly thing to do, plant these seeds. And once these trees grow, your future generations can have some trees. And as long as you know how to cut those trees down, once they grow, and you can build your house in the future. And they think because they didn't give you a pack of seeds, plant trees, because that is where we are in this climate change discussion that we are often left out of too, that is moving forward. It's back to the whole crumb. They're not even trying to build a house and just do one room the way they desire versus what we are desire. We still have to do all the work in getting us where we are in the future without people even moving out the way.
I have this quote, and I'm just thinking about this whole fascinating conversation that we're having from James Baldwin, who is one of my favorites, who stated, you know, that I love America more than any other country in the world. And exactly for this reason, I insist on the right to criticize her perpetually. Right. And, you know, I've been able to go abroad, and I love America. And I also love Charlottesville. And I think that, you know, part of that love allows me to have the right to be critical of it when I need to. And I think that is unfortunate that some people feel like they have the right to be critical of the society in which they live, but some people don't. And therein lies the issue. So do we have the same right to be critical of those things that we do love because we had a major hand in the participation in its construction? I mean, the whole 1619 project is really a reclamation of the narrative project to say that this is what we constructed, we love it, we belong, and as the poet Sean Diddy Combs once said, we ain't going nowhere, you know, that we can love it and criticize it at the same time.
Why?
And this idea too, that somehow critique is bad, critique is ungrateful, has to do with, I think, some of the assumed postures people would rather have, people want Black people to have. There seems to be this desire in some liberal, white liberal circles, and conservatives as well, that there's not enough Black gratitude. You've noticed that? They're always wanting us to be grateful for something. Grateful to whom for what? They want us to be grateful for the chains. They want us to be grateful for everything. They want us to be grateful actually for slavery, because if it wasn't for slavery, we couldn't have come here and become Christians. Aren't we lucky? And now we get to be Americans too. It's perverse. It is absolutely perverse that we, and this is why I believe that the precision in language is so important. And this is why being honest about the stories of our past are so crucial. When you were talking about the right to criticize America, I went immediately to Dred Scott. And when a Supreme Court said that Black men have no rights to which white men are bound to respect, that rights discourse has continued through American jurisprudence up until today. Of course, these cases are no longer valid, but the idea that our government and what is considered just and civic practice was deliberately built on our violent exclusion. And there is still a little bit of that vibe. Yeah, that residue is still there. And this is why I am convinced that the past is the key to the future. And if you have people who are dishonest about that, who do not want to look at their past, who want to constantly be forgiven and expunged for the racist actions that were taken on their behalf, as well as racist institutions that were designed for the protection and promotion of whiteness, then there is no forward momentum that can happen, not without accountability.
Yeah, there's a question here from that says, honestly, where do you see Charlottesville in 50 years? That's a long time away, but let's show
it. Same.
Right, the historian in me says, well,
I love when you say honestly as if you're gonna say anything other than that. 50 years is gonna be the same or worse.
Yeah, same.
It's sad that's it, that you don't have
hope.
You keep the hope to change it. I'm even thinking, like, what is another, you know, I put you know, Holly's, West, my, you know, since we were the last three Black people on council together, 12 years, and that's not enough. Maybe we were all on there together, right? That would have been, you know, would have done, you know, more. But with some kind of, with the changing that's happening when you go to Preston Avenue, when you see, the Monticello Dairy Project, when you see who is frequenting that space, a community that was ours and now it's clearly not, and it's not, you know, going to be, when their houses for sale for $449,000 for a 2-bedroom, 1-bath, and when you have developers coming before you. The last developer was before us, a project I didn't vote on a year ago, where they looked at code and said, hey, we're going to use, it's where the Habitat building is on Harris Street, that land and the adjacent land. We want to use the land that there's already a building on in our acreage to determine our by right amount. And our staff said, oh, yeah, that's legal. Are they knocking the building down? No. So you're not planning on building on the building, but you're using the land to say that you can build 51 units when you wouldn't be able to build 51 units if you didn't use that land, and you're not planning on building on that building, that on that land, because the building's already there. And then they came and asked for an SUP and asked for, I think, 101 units. And they promised us 5 affordable units. And then they came back the last council meeting and asked for 15 additional units because they've, you know, done their thing, architecture, everybody in, and they know that they can get 15 more units in there. So they've gone from where I think they probably would have had 20, 30 units by right before they, you know, worked around the law, got to 50, and now they're up to 116 units on land where by right. And all we're getting out of that is 5 affordable units. And when I asked them, what were they offering us for the new SUP, they reminded me they didn't have to give the 5 units, but they were going to clarify the language that they gave us last year and to make sure that the 5 units happen. And everybody else sat there and said, okay, this is good because we need housing, even if, you know, only certain people can live in it. And the developer said, you know, I've been in contact, you know, we're going to do this partnership with CRHA for the affordable to make sure vouchers, whatever, been used. So how has that conversation gone with the ED of CRHA? Oh, I haven't talked to them. Where else would that happen? Where in white America could somebody come, offer absolutely nothing, some crumbs, get, you know, almost 100 units more than they would be able to get by right and give nothing back to the community? How is that not pillaging, right? And who does that push out and displace from the community? Who are going to be the occupants of those 111 units? And my colleagues say, oh, they could build anything. They don't have to build anything because you are letting them get away with everything here. And so I sat there and called all of that out, which is what people are really saying when they don't want me here, because they expected someone to be incompetent showing up in 2018. And then they got me, and I pay really close attention, and I'm not afraid of challenging them. And I do know what I'm talking about. And if I'm in the room and I don't know what I'm talking about, I'm not afraid of that either. I'm going to leave with more knowledge than I came in the room with. So I ask a lot of questions, and I call them on their BS. So if that is the type of deals that council is voting on, that tells you how this community is going to be in 50 years. Mm-hmm. And all of these educated, smart people in Charlottesville with good intentions, they don't even pay attention. They pay attention to what I say, my word choice. And I've explained that before. I did struggle with whether I was going to use 2 words, but it wasn't the 2 people had a problem with. But they miss conversations like that, where the Preston Avenue looks totally different. They know it's gonna look totally different, and there's no advocacy around how to make Black neighborhoods safe and secure. We haven't voted on the grant to help homeowners for 2 years. And my colleagues have been very comfortable with saying that is something that I move very quickly on. And the city staff thinks that we are doing enough. But you tell that to the homeowners whose property values are increasing every year to continue to wait. And then we talk about displacement. But when we have a tool to keep people here or attempt to keep people here, we don't invest in it. We tell them that they can wait for 3 years to get the next investment. But meanwhile, we vote on these developments every time they are in front of us and allow developers to take over the community and people to lose their home. If I need to explain to you why people may need a grant during a pandemic where Black people are primarily the ones who are facing the gravest health consequences because already the health disparities that exist because of white supremacy and racism. And I need to explain to you how we need to do everything in our power to make sure that our low income community members are taken care of during a pandemic, and you do anything but that, but then get upset with me because I'm persistent. 15 years, is today. Today was 50 years ago.
Yeah. We've got one question, which will be our, I think, depending on how the conversation goes, because you all are okay with staying a couple minutes longer. Is that correct? Depending on how the conversation goes. Okay, so the question is, with all that's happened here and what continues to evolve all around us, what's it going to take to bring more Blacks to the front lines of the struggle? Not the well-meaning, well-intentioned white allies or accomplices, but Black people. Go ahead, Lisa.
So I know I keep raising my hand, my bad. I really want to caution us, and I thank you so much for the question, Don. I want to caution us against this deficit model of Black people not doing enough. I really do. I feel like, as it has always been the case with movements for freedom, that these are not mass movements. People, if you look back at the history of the civil rights movement in both its first, second, and third waves, the stuff that Dr. King was doing, everybody in the world was not out there with him. There were people in his own church who thought he was being ridiculous. There were Black folks who disagreed. I mean, so like this idea that somehow that we need, basically, this needs to be a movement where every single person is involved. Not everyone is able to do the kind of frontline work, either direct action or these other type of protest, direct movements in the streets. Not everyone is able to do that. And I just would love to give us, instead of giving Black folks an assignment, you know, about what we need to be doing more of, I would like to give us some credit, some ease. You know, I feel like we are this constant demand to do more always is just a lot. And I think that it's really worth considering. Again, I'm not one who is like all excited about white allies or whatnot, but I do think that it's worth really taking to heart that white supremacy is a problem that white people created, a system for their own benefit, and that they have to have a significant role in the dismantling of it. And it can't come from, you know, the tutoring of being a good Black friend or whatever. I just feel like we're doing enough. I honestly do. I feel like Black people have done enough and continue to do enough and do a lot already. And I would just caution us against the idea that somehow our liberation is going to be tied to us working for it enough to earn it. You know what I mean? That doesn't, and I'm sure that's not what the question is asking, but what I want to be very cautious about this impulse to do more. I personally struggle with this a lot. I'm someone who always feels like she's never done enough, you know, which even looking objectively at it seems a bit like nonsensical, but I do want us to just, you know, since we got here, we have done nothing but work. In some way or another. And the idea that somehow the key to our freedom is more work just around the corner, I don't buy it. There's gotta be another way. And I know there is.
I also think, you know, just to add to that, like the work has been done. We've been doing the work. We're consistent on the work. We don't need more work. But I do think I would love to see Black Charlottesville lean into some joy. I would love to see Black Charlottesville cultivating spaces where we can be us, where we can come together, where we can build together, where we can thrive as a community, you know? And I look around and I just don't see those spaces anymore. It feels like we used to have those spaces and now we don't. So my hope for Black Charlottesville is that we'll one day have spaces where we can just go hang out on a Wednesday or a Thursday or Friday, where we can go take up space. Maybe we choose a place and take that place over for a night. You know, I think the resistance here has to be like a steadfast and unrelenting pursuit of Black joy.
And to add on to that, I've heard it once said that the opposite of trauma is not resilience. The opposite of trauma is joy, right? And so we are always often taught that in order to create an antidote for our trauma, then we have to be more resilient. But actually, the antidote to the trauma is to actually celebrate and be more joyful. And And that's why, you know, I'm a little bit more of an optimist, because I exist in this kind of Afrofuturist reality, like, that I'm trying to, like, bring manifest into my world and say, like, yo, I'm trying to be joyful. If I spend my time, if I spend too much time, you know, not focusing on my wholeness, then it's going to be a self fulfilling prophecy, that I will kill myself, you know, trying to live up to these standards instead of just being me, just being me. And like, and I think, like, we gotta do more, like, yo, I'm just gonna be me.
Yeah. I think that's even in how we participate in the struggle as well. I think it's finding how do we do it instead of it being like this cookie cutter way of old, like how you approach it. You know, me and my wife personally, we can't stand on the front line in a way that some people would like to, because we're not young anymore. I mean, it's just that simple. We got four kids that we're trying to raise, and our way of combating the struggle is homeschooling, is creating entrepreneurial ventures, and, you know, showing our kids how to, like, be brave and how to not be limited by what people say about you, or about what people actually try to do to you. But like Sarah said, living from, like, your imagination instead of living from what, you know, used to be true. And that don't mean that we disregard our history, because we know it, but we got to imagine something greater. And so that's what we are trying to do. And that's how we contribute to the struggle. So I'm not sure exactly what Don meant about Black people being on the front lines, but we've always been on the front lines, man. Like, we never left. Some of us has just gotten older, and some of that frontline game is a young man's sport, and we just not young anymore. You know, you got to be in a big Black populated college town to possibly see Black people on the front line, because that's where the young people are who have stuff to lose. But people like the mayor, she is less that she wants to jeopardize, but also she's still putting it on the line. So I'm not sure how we left the front lines, honestly.
And I think it's important. I mean, one thing that I would like to first say is that, you know, I used to say it all the time, that the women who fed the leaders on the front lines of the movement were as important as the leaders who were on the front line of the movement, right? And they were women, back to wheel and that archaic thinking, but they were often, you know, the women of, you know, the times back there. And I used to, you know, read about them and to just think of just how, you know, how much love you have to pour and how much dedication and time you have to take to, you know, feed people well and give them enough joy in those meals so that they can go out and fight the fight. But that's one of the things that you know, thinking back to how many people in this community that even the way they fight is different, and just figuring out, you know, how to honor that. You never see my family anywhere, and that, you know, is keeping them safe is the main reason for that, but they are just not like I am. And it is important for us to honor that in the, you know, people that we come in contact. Not everybody is interested. My family wished I was less interested, you know. But what people do, making sure that we show them appreciation and value, even the people who will call or send a message and it'll say, I don't know how you do it, but I'm here for you. I'm praying for you. You know, that is enough to get me through my next 45, 60 minute debate, argument, you know, whatever, my moment of being angry, because I am angry sometimes. And I say that often. It's an emotion. Everybody else can use it. I can use it when it comes up. I don't have to run from it. And this notion that being angry and Black and woman means something. Yes, it does. And when you get that energy, you deserve it. And when it's time to go back and experience this joy all of you are talking about, you know, Wes and I did the Facebook Live and he called me and said, someone said, oh, I didn't know she laughed that much because you're not my friend. That's how you know, but everybody who's my friend, we have a good time. And that's like immediately following some very, you know, heavy discussion. I can always move through that. But I think back to, you know, the joy is a big piece. And then a few years ago, all of us, Holly, Mrs. Turner, you know, a lot of us ended up in front of this woman, Pamela, who I recently brought back to talk about climate change and how equity fits into that. But we ended up in a room talking about health. And so that is something that I'm being reminded of over the past year after coming out of, you know, a year. And it wasn't the pandemic, because the pandemic I could have probably done in my sleep. That tells you what the rest of my life was like last year. But it's that reminder, losing my grandmother and knowing, you know, how hard she worked. And even though she was just one of the most beautiful expressions of joy and grace, I know a lot of the struggles that she went through. And that has been a reminder to me to take better care of myself. And I just try to remind myself, like, what am I doing all this work for? I'm doing it so that somebody's grandmother in the future can actually experience more peace, right? And don't have to work through this world in pain, staying at jobs where they suffer, you know? So it has just been a reminder of, you know, to remind us and be a better model for how we care for ourselves so that we can do this work. So along with the joy, and I, you know, I brought Mrs. Turner and Holly, they're now gone. And I think all of those different income levels, all the different circles, the women in those, there were women from Hardy Drive in that same room. We all, no matter what income level, found ourselves in this space where being Black in this country destroys your health, no matter how many resources you have. And the trauma associated with it. And so I think it's a good, it is important for us to remember that taking care of ourselves, taking care of one another, making sure we have that joy, because we know how valuable laughter as medicine is. Those are some things that I've been reminded through my trying to deal with my grief, which I've been working, so I haven't really sat with that. That's unhealthy, so I need to do that. But it's how do we care for each other? And I think that we can do that better. And I hope that we begin to do that better, because then we have more stamina for the fight. And we have more clarity while we're trying to do the fight. And that's when I see people out running that hadn't been running. You know, I even try to map the miles I do on my treadmill in a week with the amount of miles Wes does. I got this whole thing going on. I'm like, you increasing your mileage too quickly. You need to slow down, because it's not working no matter how I divide it by seven, you know. But even I wasn't working out a lot, but even though I'm not out there in the early mornings with them, their health, you know, they're driving me to focus on my health better. And so I think even by default, once we start doing better, other people start doing better. And we may never even know some of those stories. That's the beauty of, you know, what we're, you know, what people like, what will them, what they're doing. And, you know, I think we find that joy through taking better care of ourselves and each other.
So I think that I want to say thank you so much to all of you. I have had a very fruitful time speaking with friends, talking about things that are important and matter, creating clarity for those people who were not not clear before. I think they should be clear now on what it means when you unmask the illusion, what you mean when you say that Charlottesville is a beautiful ugly, that we all have to face all our truths and work towards creating better spaces than those truths are. And so I'd like to applaud you all and say thank you from the bottom of my heart for taking your time to do this with me. I greatly appreciate it. I look forward to seeing you all in person in some other forms. Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a great night.
Thank you.